spirit of the organization.
This call is now being recorded.
Whereas the behavioral theories, they have considered the behavioral aspect or the human aspects. So for that reason, the theories which are going to discuss, which include the Elton Mayo's Hawthorne studies, then Maslow's need hierarchy, Hertzberg's motivation theories, and McGregor's participation theory. All these theories are specifically concerned with human behavior. Now, coming to the first part of it, let us discuss what are the basic features of behavioral theory. As I have already told you, that this is basically on human aspect of the organization. So the features will also consider the human aspect of the organization. The first one is the point, as you can, okay. So let me tell you the basic features of behavioral theories. These are motivation, social system, leadership, communication, and employee development. Now, coming to motivation, we always know that human beings are not machines. They need certain motivation to work. So to show their higher productivity and moral level, motivation is important. The next one is social system. Social system means whenever the human beings are working in the organization, they interact with each other. The formal groups are there. Also, the informal friendship groups are there. So social system exists. The next one is leadership. Now, leadership shows that whenever we are talking about making people work, making them increase their productivity, there has to be a leader. The leadership quality has to be there, which will motivate them to work. The next is communication. Communication is another important factor of behavioral theories, because whenever we talk about the human beings, the employees, communication is always there. Communication is always there, maybe formal, maybe informal, but it always is there. The next one is employee development. Now, this employee development talks about upgrading the employee skill, the managerial skill, the technical skill. So that part is of employee development. Now, coming to the next one, which is Elton Mayo's Hawthorne studies. As the name suggests, Hawthorne studies, Elton Mayo, who is basically a psychologist. Sir, please, the next slide. So the next slide, please. Okay, thank you. Now, so Elton Mayo, who is an Australian psychologist, he has proposed this theory. According to him, he said that morale is greater when the worker's work is given importance and it is considered as valuable. If that is communicated to the workers, then they are productivity will also increase. Now, Hawthorne studies is initially it was conducted in the General Electric's company, the Hawthorne plant of it. Now, what happened was that there they have conducted a series of experiments on the workers, and they have, sir, please the next slide. The next slide, the slides, please, sir. Okay, okay, sir.
Yes, ma'am, I'm just doing it.
Okay, let us continue. Now, when it comes to this particular theory, Hawthorne's study, it has, like, as I have told you, that they have conducted the research on different, the group of workers in the General Western Electric's company. Now, in their Hawthorne plant, the experiments were conducted. For that reason, this theory got this name, Hawthorne studies. Now, in this, what they have done is the physical aspect of the work, the mental aspect of the work, the economic and social aspect of the work, every variable was considered while conducting these studies. Now, in this, what happened was that they wanted to know how the workers interact with each other. If they are not allowed to interact, then what happens? If the workers know that the manager is observing them, how it is affecting their productivity? If they know that the manager is not there, how it is affecting their productivity? How the working conditions, if you like conduct experiment on that, like increasing the brightness, decreasing the brightness, providing them a spacious room. If you do all these things, then providing them breaks during work, how many breaks is productive, how many breaks is unproductive. So by conducting different types of experiments, the theory has come up with certain results, sir. Let us go to the result slide, please. The next one. The next slide, please. So can we go to the next slide? Okay, now let us discuss the results. Under this study, the results are it were divided into different aspects of it, like variables. One is social factor, one is informal groups, one is leadership, one is communication. Now, the first one is social groups. In social groups, or sorry, the social factors. In social
Ma'am,
factors,
actually,
what
I'm
happened
doing it,
that
but somehow it is
it has
taking
been
slightly late to
it has
TV.
been shown that when employees are allowed to interact with each other, when employees have the specific norms to work, that plays a very important role in motivating the employees to work more. The next one is informal groups. Informal groups are as important as formal groups. Why so? Because even if the formal groups are there, like who will be working in which batch, who will be working in which group, that is decided by the organization. But apart from that, the workers, they develop their reference group, they develop their friendship group in which they interact, share informations. Now, informal groups, through this also, the favorable impact can be shown in the productivity and attitude of the workers. The next one is leadership. Now, leadership says that with proper supervision, the workers can produce more. They will be motivated. They will be they will be motivated towards contributing towards the productivity and efficient use of time and resources. The next is communication. Communication is, it has been observed that in the decision making process, if the workers' participation is allowed, then the workers feel that they are part of the organization for which they will take responsibility of the outcome. Now, so that also can help the worker to be motivated because it provides some the recognition towards the contribution of the worker. The next is the balanced approach. Balanced approach says that the management must take into account every aspect of the problem of the worker, be it the technical aspect, be it their mental aspect or their personal aspect. The organization must, or the management must take care of, must go for a balanced approach while considering the worker's performance and productivity. Now let us go to the next one, which is Maslow's need hierarchy. Now Maslow's need hierarchy, Abraham Maslow, who is a renowned sociologist, he has proposed this one, this need hierarchy. Basically, he has given a pyramidal structure in which he has shown that every human has five levels of needs. It starts with the physiological need, then it goes to safety and security, then social needs, then esteem needs, and then self-actualization needs. Now, according to this theory, whenever we want to do something, we want to motivate ourselves to be productive, to be efficient, but unless we achieve the first order need, we won't go to the next order of need. So physiological need comes as the most basic order need, which talks about the basic needs of a human being, like food, clothing, shelter, water, air, all these things. Unless we are able to get this, we won't be thinking about safety and security. The next is safety and security. So in the safety and security, here the need involves the financial security, health and well-being. If accidents or injuries occur, then how it will be mitigated, how it will be taken care of. All these needs will come only when we achieve the first level of need, which is physiological need. The next one is the social need. Now, after we have achieved this, the basic two, next we will go for the social need. The social need talks about, like, we are called as humans who are the social animals. Why we are social animals? Because we stay in a group, we have a family, we interact with each other more often. So for that reason, we always need this communication part.
only when we are in a social environment, then only we communicate, and it is the need of us to communicate. So the emotional relationship, that also drives the human behavior. So the social need talks about the emotional relationships of the human being. The next one is esteem need. Now this self-esteem need is the respect and appreciation of others towards a particular human being. That is called as the esteem needs. Now in esteem needs, we can talk about self-confidence, then achievement, the competence, knowledge, independence of the self. All these will come under esteem needs. So that can be related to the level of position you have in the organization, the source, the kind of income you have, the kind of society in which you reside in. From all these, we derive our esteem. The last one is self-actualization. That is the highest order need of in the Maslow's need hierarchy. Now self-actualization says that what a man can be, he must be. That means whatever you can be able to achieve, when you achieve everything, that is called as you have reached the self-actualization level. So this is all about Maslow's need hierarchy. Coming to the next one, which is Hertzberg's motivation hygiene theory. Now, Hertzberg is an American psychologist. He has said that whenever we talk about different factors which are existing in the organization, they can be categorized into two aspects. One is the motivators, one is the hygiene. So according to him, he said, for satisfaction, the opposite is not dissatisfaction. Rather, satisfaction's opposite is no satisfaction, and dissatisfaction's opposite word is no dissatisfaction. Now, so he has explained these two concepts through the help of motivators and hygiene factors. Now, he said that the next slide, please, sir. Now, he said that the hygiene factors are there who exist in the organization, who does not, these factors do not work specifically as motivators. For example, when you are sitting in a classroom, the presence of desk, bench, a fan, light bulb, or a blackboard, that will not motivate you to study. But the absence of it can make you dissatisfied. Means, the moment you enter into the classroom, you obviously expect these things to be there. So if the presence does not motivate you, but the absence can dissatisfy you. So that is the concept of hygiene factors. So that is why these hygiene factors are considered as maintenance factors. The example which I given, like you can see in the slide, that the company policies, supervision, the relationship which are existing, the working condition, remuneration, salary, security, all these are, means whenever you join a job, you will get a salary. So that is something which you expect, it means expect the presence of the salary, the working condition, the basic things which are provided to you, the security related to your, like the insurance which is given by the company, and all these kind of things which are present, these are considered as the hygiene factor. Whereas when it comes to motivators are the factors which, the presence of which will motivate the employees to increase their productivity. Now these are like the, you can see, achievement, recognition, the work itself, the responsibility which is given to you, the advancement and growth opportunities which is provided by the organization, all these will be considered as motivators. Because the moment you do something and you get recognition for that, it will motivate you to perform in a better level or to maintain that superior level of productivity. So this one is, these particular factors, the presence of it will definitely motivate the workers to be more productive and efficient. The next one is MacGregor's participation theory. Sir, please, the next slide. Now, in MacGregor's participation theory, Douglas MacGregor, who was a management professor in MIT Sloan University School of Management, he has said that basically the workers are divided into two categories. So he has proposed this theory X and theory Y. Now he said that whenever, means two categories of workers are there. Some categories of workers are there who are self-motivated. They who means they took initiative, they show leadership characteristics. But some workers are there who inherently they do not like working, they avoid responsibility, they need information, they need direction every time, then they have to be controlled, they have to be forced to work. Sir, please, the next slide. Now, so they do not have any ambition and incentive to work. So for them, the type of management style will be different. For theory Y people, the type of management style will be different. Now, theory Y people, how they are? They take responsibility, they are motivated, they seek responsibility, they consider work as a natural part of it. So this theory proposes that whenever we talk about managing the people, depending on to which category they belong to, whether they are theory X type people or theory Y type people, the management style, the rules, regulations of the organization need to be derived accordingly. So that is the participation theory by McGregor. Now, let us come to the next part of the discussion, which talks about the systems and contingency approach to management. Now, all the parts which we have discussed, like for example, we have discussed about this scientific management theory, we have discussed about 14 principles of management, we have discussed about this behavioral aspect of it. Now, no particular concept has talked about like how this environment is related to the organization and how organization functions in a certain type of environment. Now, the first one is systems approach. Now, systems approach says that in the organization, everything is interrelated. It is considered as an entire system rather than a part of it. So, systems approach, it views the organization as a unified, purposeful system composed of interrelated parts. These interrelated parts can be different levels of management, the different departments which exist, the internal environment, the external environment, and all the different business units of the organization wherever it is present. So considering it in the entirety, it will be the systems approach of the organization. Now, let us discuss the advantages of systems approach. Now, systems approach, the advantages are, like, the first one is it aims at meaningful analysis of the organization. Why so? Because it considers each and every part and subpart which is there in the organization. So for that reason, whenever you get to analyze the organization, it provides a very meaningful approach to understanding the organization. Next is it facilitates interaction between organization and its environment. Like I already have told you, that the organization, it is the internal environment, the external environment, and all the parts are considered when we talk about the systems approach. So it facilitates interaction between the organization and the environment. The next is it guides the manager to avoid analyzing problems in isolation. In isolation means the moment you consider the organization as parts only. This, it can be in different levels, it can understand the organization in different levels or in the context of different departments. Now, when we do that, we only will be focused on one particular aspect of the organization by neglecting the other aspects of the organization or the context of understanding. But under the systems approach, we understand the organization as a whole. So for that reason, it can give a holistic approach in understanding of the organization. The next one is disadvantages of systems approach. Now, in disadvantages of systems approach, it says the first one is it does not recognize the differences in the systems. That means whenever we understand the organization as its entirety, we somehow lose focus on understanding the differences which exist between the different parts. Now, that can be a limitation of this particular theory. The next is, it does not specify the nature of interaction and interdependencies. That means the degree to which interaction happens between the internal and external environments, the degree of interaction which happens between different levels of the organization or different functional parts of the organization and the interdependency, how they are, up to what degree they are dependent on each other. These things are not clearly shown in under this approach. The next is, it cannot be directly applied to practical problems. As this theory, this particular approach is more of a conceptual approach than an applied approach. So because of that, the practical problems, when they occur, they might not guide the management to take appropriate actions. Now, let us go to the next one, which one is features of systems approach. Now, first one is hierarchy of subsystems. Like I have told you, different levels of management exist in the organization. So these different parts, the subsystems, they are called as the subsystems. So how they, means which one will come under what, then how they are related to each other, these will be the hierarchy of subsystems. Next one is interrelated and interdependent. As we know, different subsystems exist in the whole system, so they will obviously be interrelated and they are interdependent, as because they are part of the same organization. Next is the boundary. Here, from the beginning, I have told you that there is internal environment, there is external environment. So this approach clearly defines what is within the organization and what is outside the organization. For example, organizational structure, the way the work is divided, the levels in the organization, how many departments will be in the organization, that will be within the boundary of the organization. Whereas the political environment, the technological environment, legal, social environment, all these will be on outside of the organization. So that will be outside of the boundary. So this boundary is clearly defined. Next is open system. Open system means, as we know, the interaction happens between internal environment and the external environment. So the interaction happens, which makes the system an open system. Next is adaptive. Adaptive means whenever there is a change in the external environment, then the internal environment gets adjusted accordingly. So that is adaptive. Next is dynamic. So this external environment, internal environment, they are not static. Whenever there is change in the internal will change. So accordingly, subsystems will change. So that's why it is dynamic. The next is multidisciplinary. Why it is multidisciplinary? Because it takes its concepts from different disciplines like economics, statistics, sociology, psychology, operational research, mathematics, engineering. So from all these disciplines, the system approach has taken its concept. So it is multidisciplinary. The next one is the evaluation of the systems approach. Now, under this evaluation, we will be discussing the contribution of it and the limitation of it. The first one is the contribution of it. So how it is helpful for the organization. Now, so as you can see, a few points I mentioned over here. First one is, it enables the manager to think correctly and positively. Why so? Because as we are discussing it as an entire system, we do not have, the means the managers, they do not have a narrow focus on a specific context or a specific aspect of the organization. For that reason, the manager gets a holistic view of the organization. For this reason, they can think correctly and positively about how to get things done. The next is, it follows management by objective. As we know, that systems approach is about the organization rather concentrating on the parts. It concentrates on the entire system. So achievement of the objective is the primary focus over here. So like management by objective, the objective will be defined and accordingly it will trickle down to the different departments and the different levels and the subsystems. The next point is, it helps the manager in understanding the impact of environmental factor as the environment is dynamic. So here, the interaction between internal environment and external environment, continuously that happens. So because of that, the managers develop this understanding that how the external environment can have an impact on the internal environment of the organization. The next is, it tells the manager about the multi-level and multi-dimensional features of the management. Now, as it is considered as an entire system, so all the subsystems like micro and macro level, the micro level and the macro level. Micro level are the small subsystems, whereas macro level is the whole business system. The when systems approach is applied, the manager develops this understanding between the interaction of sorry the interaction of between the micro level and the macro level. The next one is system approach to management also implies that managers should have an analytical observational power. Now, regardless of the area in which the manager functions, the manager develops an understanding of the different aspects of the organization. To develop that understanding of all the different aspects of the organization, manager develops an analytical frame of mind, the observational power. The next is new ideas should also be accepted by manager, even from a lower level employee. Now, as we know that organization consists of three levels, the top level, the middle level, and the lower level. So all of the levels, they have their contribution towards the achievement of the organizational objective. So here, it is not that the only the top level management or the lower level management, they will be taking the decisions and they will know everything. Also, the lower level managers, the employees should be considered as they are the frontline workers and they understand the problem if it occurs in a more intimate way than the other managers. So for that reason, this talks about including the lower level employees also in the decision-making process. Now, coming to the next one, which is the limitation of systems approach. Now, limitations of systems approach, it talks of the first one is it lacks universality. Now, it lacks universality means the moment we talk about systems approach, a big organization comes to mind. So whether it will be applicable to a small organization and how it will be applicable to production or production-oriented organization, how it will be applicable to the service-oriented organizations. So these things were not clear. So that is one of the limitations. Next is it does not explain the relationship among different variables. Now, how the variables, even though all the subsystems are interrelated to each other, but the impact of certain subsystems will be more on the others in comparison to certain other subsystems. So here, this particular theory does not explain exactly how these variables they impact each other. The next is all subsystems are interrelated and interdependent, but to what extent that is not explained. The next is, this approach is over-conceptual, like I have told you before, that more theoretical aspect is given over here in this approach, but the applicability part of it, how it will be applicable in a real-life situation, that was not clear. So for that reason, it is considered as an over-conceptual theory. The next one is, it does not explain how the subsystem of the specific organization is uniquely related in a given environment. Now, every organization works in a different kind of environment. Now, how these subsystems which are existing in the organization, how they are related to that environment and up to what degree they get affected, this is again not clearly mentioned or explained in under this theory. So that is another of the limitation. Next is the contingency approach. As the name suggests, contingency means according to the situation when you behave. That is known as contingency. So the possibility and in broad sense, it means to be prepared for every circumstance and situation. Now we can say contingency approach is derived from the concepts of systems approach. Now, sir, please the next slide. So contingency approach basically says managers should not take decision according to the principles, rather they must take decisions according to the situation. Now coming to the features of the contingency approach, the first one is the based on situation. Like I have told you, contingency, the word itself means that management styles according to the demand of the situation. So whatever the situation demands, accordingly the management style will be derived or developed. Next is it provides solution. It provides solution means like whenever contingency approach is practiced in the organization, they
develop different scenarios for different circumstances. If this happens, then what? If this happens, then what? So this kind of scenarios are already created, so they provide for different types of solutions. The next is interrelationships. Now, interrelationships, it says that good interrelationship between situational variables and managerial actions should be there. Good, it talks about establishing good interrelationship between situational variables and managerial actions, since managerial variables are totally dependent on the situational variables. So for that reason, that relationship has to be there. Next is structural adaptability. Now, let me give you an example on this. ITC. Now, ITC is famous for many of its brands, like Classmate is there, then the hotel chain is there, ITC Moria and Chola and all this kind of thing. Then ITC's brands are like Wheels is there, Wheels Lifestyle is there. So ITC Ashirwad is there. So ITC has Fiamma de Ville. So ITC has a lot of brands. But when the company was in the primary stage of the company, it was only focused on the tobacco products. Now, when a large number of taxes levied because of the change in government taxation policy, ITC has decided that it cannot concentrate around one type of product, rather it should diversify the business. So it has decided to go to office stationeries, then FMCG sector, and this hospitality sector. So it has decided to do that. Now, depending on the environment has forced ITC to change its structure. So structural adaptability is according to the situation when the organization is ready to change its structure to survive and to flourish. The next one is practical approach. Now, why it is practical approach? Because contingency theory takes into account the change in situation in comparison to other theories, which are basically on the principles. Whereas contingency approach is a very flexible one, which takes into account of all the changes in the situations. So for that reason, it is more practical. Next is analytical, because according to the demand of the situation, how it changes, accordingly, the managerial actions also changes. So because of that, the analytical part is there. The next is suggest alternatives. Now, this not only give quantitative and qualitative suggestion, also it provides various alternatives. Like in a particular situation, what can be applied, which will generate maximum efficiency for the organization. Next is improved approach. Now, why contingency approach is considered to be an improved approach? Because it provides a modern view in comparison to the pragmatic method of having certain principles, rules, and applying that regardless of the situation. This particular approach has considered the situational variables and how to change your management style accordingly. So for that reason, it is considered as an improved approach. The next one is limitations of contingency approach. Now, the first one is lack of theoretical base. As I have told you, contingency approach is a very highly flexible one. It doesn't have a lot of principles or rules. So for that reason, is one limitation is that it is the lack of theoretical base. Next is difficulty in testing. Difficulty in testing also, because here the approach is based on experience and practices. So you do not have much of a set of principles and rules to rely upon to. So for that reason, it is kind of a trial and error. So difficulty in testing. Next is limitation of proactiveness. So how far an organization can be proactive? Contingency approach, the extent to which you are reactive, if that gets reduced and the desire to be proactive is much, how it is going to affect the organization? Because there has to be a balance between being reactive and being proactive. The next is tedious. Why it is tedious? Because you do not have a specific proper solution according to a situation. It requires a lot of a complex analysis of the situation. You need to consider a lot of variables. How it will be means you have to come up with different scenarios. So for that reason, it takes a lot of time and energy and effort. For that reason, it is called a, it is also tedious. The next is, let us discuss the relationship between system and contingency approach. Now, system approach, like I have told you, it has failed to establish a relationship between organization and management, sorry, organization and environment, whereas the contingency approach has clearly shown how the organization's internal environment and the external environment, they are interrelated with each other. The next is contingency approach, it follows basic ideas and concepts, whereas the systems approach is more towards manager, means it is not targeted towards the managerial action. Next is, systems approach is more concentrated on human behavior. Systems approach is more concentrated on human behavior and the various parts of the organization. So as while discussing it, we always talk about communication, coordination, different subsystems, how they are interdependent. So systems approach is more concentrated towards the human behavior, whereas the contingency approach, it concentrates on the structural adaptation of the organization. That means it has considered both the structural adaptation and how the internal and environment, internal and the external environment, they gel well together. The next is, contingency approach is built upon the systems approach. As I have told you, contingency approach does not have much of the theoretical base, whereas the systems approach, it is more of a conceptual thing. So contingency approach is derived from the systems approach. So thank you all. This is all about the first part of your principles of management, functions and principles. Now let us go to the next part, which talks about controlling and coordination. Sir, can we have the slide, please? Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, yes, sir. No, thank you, sir. Now, so I hope that you all have gone through planning, organizing, staffing, directing, the first four functions related to the management activities. Now, controlling is the last and very important function when it comes to the management functions. Now, planning, organizing, staffing, and directing, in that, the basic work, how it will be done, how it will be, planning is about like how the work will be done, when, how, where, what, all these things are discussed. Next, when it comes to organizing, how it will be divided, who will be doing what, and all this kind of, how the coordination will happen. So that is there. Then staffing is employing the right person in the right job, and directing to give them instructions, directions to carry out the work. Now, when it comes to controlling, controlling is the last function of the management, and it is about ensuring whatever was planned before, whether the organization, whether the managers, they are able to achieve that one. For that reason, this controlling mechanism is there. Sir, please, the next slide. So controlling is basically, it is a process which is there to ensure that whatever was planned, it is ensured in the latter stages properly. And if any discrepancy occurs, why it occurs and how it will be rectified. Now, meaning of controlling, here two definitions are given. So control is the process of taking steps to bring actual result and desired result closer together. That means the gap between the actual result and the desired, which was already decided in the planning phase, the gap between these two should not be a big one. So planning, the controlling function, it ensures that whatever was planned for, that is being achieved by removing the
hurdles and the like the problems or issues which occur in the way. Now, Sartha, please the next slide. Now, so nature and characteristics of controlling, let us discuss that one. The first one is fundamental managerial function. Now, it is considered as a fundamental managerial function because whenever we say what are the managerial functions, so planning, organizing, staffing, directing, and controlling is the answer. So controlling is considered to be a fundamental managerial function. Next is pervasive function. Pervasive function, why? Because it is not restricted to one level of the organization or to one department of the organization or to one job of the organization. Rather, this controlling function is present everywhere, all the levels of the organization, in all the subsystems and in all the functional areas of the organization. The next is continuous process. Continuous process, why? Because it is not done once or twice. Rather, it is done more often. Whenever the work is continuing, the controlling also is continuing. So for that reason, it is a continuous process. Next is universal process. As controlling has its applicability everywhere, so it is a universal process. Its components are universal. That means regardless of the location of the organization or the activities which are involved in it, it has like the standard, fixing the standard, assessing the actual performance, comparing the actual with the standard one, so fixing the deviation, all these things will always be present. So that's why it is universal process. Next is both the beginning and the end of management process. So here, whenever we say some deviation arises, then what happens? From this deviation, we will take the corrective actions. Now, with that corrective action, our next course of action will begin. So here it is at the beginning of it. At the end of the management process, again, we will check the actual with the standard one. So it is always there in the beginning and end of the management process. Next is, it is a forward-looking one. It always talks about improving the performance, improving the productivity, efficiency, the effectiveness of the organization, and how it does by taking corrective actions, it does it. So for that reason, it is forward-looking. Next is action-oriented. So when we talk about planning is more of a thinking process, whereas when we talk about controlling, it is on an implementation basis. So controlling is action oriented. It involves taking corrective actions to achieve the desired results. So for that reason, it is action oriented. Next is goal oriented functions. Why it is goal oriented? Because we always talk about the standard which is like decided before and the actual which is there. Now how to bridge the gap between the actual and the standard so that we can achieve which was been decided in the earlier phase. So that is why it is goal oriented function. Next is, it is a dynamic function. We can say that control is a dynamic process rather than a static process, because it changes according to the change in the circumstance. For example, I am giving of Maruti. Now Maruti Suzuki, one company. In the current situation, Maruti Suzuki is one among the company which has decided not to go for layoff of the employees. So what it decided was that it is pushing the employees to go to derive the maximum benefit of the digital platforms like social networking and everything to boost up the sales. Now, or to maintain the relationship with the customers, as the human interaction has reduced in the current scenario. Now, so here, because the situation has changed, because of that, the company also has changed its controlling mechanism. So because of this, we can say control is a dynamic process. According to the demand of the situation, it can be changed. Next is a positive process. Now, it always talks about taking corrective actions, improvement, or bridging the gap, achievement of the objective. So for that reason, when all this positivity is involved in this, that is why it is a positive process. Next is, information is the guide to controlling. Now, to control, the managers must have informations related to the standard which was set,
then how the work is functioning, how the work has divided among people, what are the basic principles, rules, regulations which are guiding that. All these informations, if it is not there, controlling cannot happen. So information is the guide to controlling. Next is emotional and motivational implications. So when we talk about this bridging the gap between standard and the actual, that means if any discrepancy occurs, any difference occurs, the employees need to be motivated emotionally, need to be continuously encouraged to show a superior level of performance or increase their skill levels and to be motivated on overall. So for that reason, emotional and motivational implication is there in the planning. Next is wide scope. The scope of control is very wide, as it considers quality, quantity, the cost of the cost of production, then the time which is required for it, the employees which are involved in it. So as it is involving everything, so it has wide scope. The last one is control of action and behavior is there. So here control does not aim at controlling the people and their freedom. Rather, it talks about controlling the action and behavior of the human being by regulating them through motivation. Next is the controlling process. Now, controlling process basically involves four stages. One is fixing standards. One is measurement of the actual performance. Third is comparison of actual and standard performance. The fourth is correcting the deviation from the standard. Now, let us discuss the first one, fixing the standard. Now, while fixing the standard, the first one is to whether the standard which is fixed, it is qualitative in nature or quantitative in nature. Quantitative, we can say man hours to be worked upon, then in a particular given period of time, how many units can be produced, the time which is required for it, then the profit which is to be earned. All these will be the quantitative aspect of the controlling or say fixing the standard. Next is qualitative standard. Qualitative standard means the morale of the worker, the motivation of the worker, then the ethical aspect of the workers. So all these will come under the qualitative standards, which cannot be measured, but also these are the important factors in performance. The next is the basis of standard. Basis of standard can be qualitative, quantity, quality, cost, and time. Now, whenever we define a standard, we can say for the in 1 hour, 10 units need to be produced. So that is a quantity. Then, if we talk about quality, it can be all employees should be punctual. Now, that is a quality aspect. Next is cost. Means whenever it talks about the time cost or the let us say the raw material, the cost of production, all these will be under the cost aspect. Next is time. Now, how effectively and efficiently the time will be utilized, be it of the workers, be it of the managers, for everybody, even the customers and the supplier, how it will be managed properly. So that is the time aspect of the standard. Next is the factors which need to be considered while setting the standard. The first one is standard should be attainable, precise, and tangible. Attainable means it should not be very high that workers will think how we are going to achieve it. That itself will demotivate the workers. It should be fixed in such a way that yes, even if it is difficult to achieve, but it's attainable or achievable. Next is precise means the instruction, the standard should be set in such a way that it is very precise, that the workers will understand it properly. Then it is tangible, means we can see that's how far we have achieved. Means if it is about converting customers to potential customers to be the actual customers of the organization, or to production of the unit, or what should be the best standard for this production work, all these things, when you can see it, then only it will be motivating, it will be contributing towards productivity. So it should be a tangible one. Next is standards should be fixed for all key areas of business. So a business can have a lot of key areas. So first, the manager need to know what are the key areas related to in which industry the business functions in. So accordingly, for all the key areas, the standard should be set. Next is, it should be in accordance with goals and policies of the organization. So whenever the organization, let us say, it wants to achieve this much of sales volume in the next quarter. So that is the goal of the organization. So accordingly, the standard will be set. Next is, standard should be expressed in quantitative term as far as possible. Why it is said to express it in quantitative terms? Because it by this way, it will be easier to measure the actual with the standard. Next is, it should be focused on achievement of the results. Now, if only the focus is on achievement of the results, then only we can know exactly what in what direction we need to work upon. The next is, standard should be flexible. Like I have explained it before, that if the situation changes, in any factor of the environment has changes and it has impact on the organizations, the functions of the organizations. So only if the standards are flexible, it will be adaptable. The next is, standards should be objective and based on facts. That means it should not be a subjective one which will be beyond understanding or comprehension of the workers and the employees. Rather, if it is objective, it will give a clear-cut idea how and when they need to work. The next is, standard should be reviewed and revised periodically. Now, if it is reviewed and revised periodically, then you will be able to see wherever the problem occurs, and likewise you can rectify as and when it is needed. Next is, standard should be set in consultation with the employees, as because the employees are crucial part who will be performing the job in the front line. So for that reason, the employee also be taken into consideration, into confidence when you state the standards. The next is, a deviation tolerance limit should be prescribed. If the standard is set at 100, it is not mandatory that every time that 100 will be achieved. So deviation up to what level will be tolerable, that also needs to be decided upon. So please, the next slide. Now, the next stage is measurement of actual performance. Now, measurement of actual performance says that whenever a measurement needs to be done, the following points need to be considered upon. The first one is, units of measuring performance should be the same. If you have considered it in the terms of units, let us say the standard is set at 100 units. At the time of measurement, you cannot say that it will be measured in terms of time. Let us say ki 1 hour or 2 hours. Ki isko 2 ghanta mein khatam hona tha. Because you have set it as units, 100 units need to be produced. So at the time of measurement, you also have to see that, okay, 100 units are produced. Not that ki kitna time mein aap produce kyo, because from the beginning, you have not set that one. Now, the next is, the fact and figure regarding performance of work should be as far as possible true. So the facts and figures related to the performance of the work means, what are the materials used, how many workers are there, what are the time or limit which is allowed to them, then the time duration, the unit they need to be produced, or whatever it is, all the facts figures should be the true one. Unless that true figures are present, the measurement of the comparing the between the actual and the standard will not be possible. Next is, the time of measurement of performance should neither be too short or too long. If it is too long, then it will lose the objectivity. Because if it is too long, people might get diverted. If it is too short, it will create a pressure on the people to perform. Okay. So because of that, it should not be very short, which will be hampering the worker, the workflow, or it should not be very long, which will be demotivating the workers. So it should be fixed at an optimal level. Sir, please, the next. Yes, thank you. Now, the next is talking about comparing the actual and the standard performance. Now, it includes two steps. One is finding out the extent of deviation. Next is identifying the cause of these deviations. Now, whenever we compare the actual performance with the standard, you cannot say that 100 was decided open, so you have to achieve 100. If the 100 number is not achieved, then it is a bad performance. No, because some deviations, as we have discussed in the previous step, some level of degree of deviation should be tolerated open. So you need to first find out what is the extent of the deviation. After that tolerance zone, what is the extent of the deviation? So if that deviation has occurred, why it has occurred? And again, you need to find out the nature of the deviation, whether it is on a positive side, whether it is on a negative side. Now, how that deviation has occurred, that also need to be, you need to find out the cause of the deviation. If it is on a positive side, then the cause of deviation will on be a positive side, and the company will be, the organization will try to maintain that to increase, to maintain the superior level of performance. If it is on a negative side, the deviation, then we need to find out what are the reasons for which the objective was not achieved, the result was not achieved, and how to improve upon them. Sir, please, the next slide. Now, so correcting deviations from the standard. Now, it has basically two principles. One is principle of critical point. One is principle of exceptions. Now, the first one is principle of critical points. Principle of critical point says that you need to find out that, according to this principle, you need to find out what are the critical points on which the organization's performance is dependent upon. So there will be some secondary points which can be neglected upon, or they can be ignored, because the focus will only be on critical points, because their achievement in those critical points will be affecting the overall performance of the organization. So that is called as principle of critical points. The next one is principle of exception. Principle of exception says that the manager should focus on more important deviations, whether good or bad. Now, so what you can tolerate, what you cannot tolerate, that you need to, the manager need to think upon. Like, if they should take corrective actions to those deviations for which the impact is a bad one. So for that reason, you need, the manager need to see whether it is good or it is bad, and it has a bearing upon the business, there the corrective actions need to be taken. Sir, please, the next slide. Now, here, taking the corrective actions. So these are the factors which need to be considered while taking the corrective action. Like the first one, corrective actions should be taken only after a thorough analysis of the cause of deviations, because sometimes there are some core causes from which some ancillary causes may get derived. Now, if you find out the core causes of it, you do not have to focus on the ancillary causes. So because if you take corrective actions for the core causes, that will eventually take care of the ancillary one. So first one is you need to be very analytical in finding out the causes of the deviation. Next is standard should be revised if that need is. Like in this current scenario, many organizations have rectified the business objectives. So because of that, whenever we talk about corrective actions, what is the lacuna that need to be defined only if the situation demands it, that need to be redefined. Next is corrective actions should be taken only by the concerned officers. Why? Because people who are trained in it, they are more skilled in it. They will be, and they are, as they are directly associated with it, the work, they have a better understanding what to do, what not to do. Next is actions should be taken without loss of time. Why? Because if you take your time in taking the corrective actions, it will lose its objectivity. For that reason, it should be taken without loss of time. Now, again, whenever the corrective actions should be taken, it is not that the entire work will be at halt. No. Along with the work, as it continues, the corrective actions should be taken so that the man hour will not be lost. Next is policies, procedures should be also be revised. Obviously, corrective actions, if a situation occurs which is unique in nature, which is of a novel characteristic or a nature, then you need to change the policies and procedures accordingly. Next is corrective action should be acceptable by the people involved in it. Now, whenever the corrective actions are taken, if it is beyond comprehension of the people who are directly involved in it, they won't be accepting it, and that will hamper the overall work altogether. For that reason, those people also need to be taken into confidence. The last one is positive deviations should also be found and cause should be analyzed and further improvement. Like I have told you, whenever a positive deviation occurs, that has to be also taken care of, because it will impact organization in a positive way. So if a positive deviation occurs, we can analyze it and how we can further develop it to improve the effectiveness of the organization. Next is the types of control. Now, so under it, basically, three types of controls are there. One is feedback control, one is concurrent control, one is feed forward control. Now, let us consider the first one, which is surplus. Yes, the feedback control. Now, in feedback control, after the work is done, then this control mechanism is applied on. Like, the work is done, it is finished, then where the problem occurred, how to improve it in the next working the phase, how it will be improved. So after it is done, you are giving a feedback. So it is called as a feedback control. Next is concurrent control. Concurrent control means here, as the work is getting done, real-time control will be there. Means as the work is progressing, then and there you check it, rectify it, and improve upon it. That is called as a concurrent control. Next is predictive or feed forward control. This control helps foresee the problem ahead of the occurrence. Ki maybe in future time these problems or issues may creep up while we work. So how to take corrective actions if these things occur? So that is called as a feed forward. Before the work is done, before the work has started, the different situations where the issue can come up, that is predicted, and accordingly corrective actions are taken. The next is levels of control. The first is strategic control and operational control. Now, strategic control, it is concerned with tracking the strategy as it is being implemented. Now, strategic control and operational control, the basic difference is that strategic control is basically at the planning phase, whereas operational control is basically at the implementation phase. So, operational control, when the strategy gets implemented, how it is running, then what are the problems are happening, how to take corrective action, that is the operational control. Whereas strategic control, it is they help in dictating the potential problems which may occur, then whether the strategy will work, what kind of environmental strategy is needed. So that is the strategic control. So operational control, as I have told you, it is more concerned with executing the strategy than formulating the strategy. Next is direct and indirect control. Now coming to direct control, direct control like cost control, quality control, budgetary control, these are direct controls because the direct involvement is there. The results can be directly compared. If let us say we talk about quality control, the moment the finished product comes, we can check it and we can say whether the quality of the product is up to the mark or not. So here you can directly check or compare between the standard and the actual. So these are called as the direct control. Whereas when it comes to indirect control, it involves like developing a control system where the control is maintained automatically, like financial control, the physical control, all these will be considered under indirect control. The next one is physical control and financial control. Now, these are part of the indirect control. See,
Physical control means it involves control over the quality and quantity. Means output standards may be fixed in like how you are setting up the output standards, whether it is per employee or per worker you are setting, or in a given time period you are setting the output standard. So that will be a physical control. Whereas the financial control is, it is expressed in terms of monetary value. Like whenever we have an output, per output, what is the cost? So cost per output will be, or cost per unit will be the financial control, will be an example of the financial control. Next is behavioral and outcome control. Now behavioral and outcome control is on the result of it, whereas behavioral control is about the process of it. Now outcome control, these are preferable when performance measures like return on asset or return on investment, that is there. So you can know what investment is done, what return you have got, and accordingly the comparison can be done. So that is outcome control. Whereas when it comes to behavioral control is about the leadership quality, the decision making process of the manager. These will be under the behavioral aspect. So behavioral control is measured in different ways, like balanced scorecard approach is there. Then the human resource accounting system is there, under which the behavioral control will be measured. Now, there are other classifications of control. For example, the first one is inventory control. Like you can see on your screen that inventory control, it is like what is there in the stock of the organization. That is known as the inventory control. So it includes supply chain management, the production control, financial flexibility, the customer satisfaction. All these aspects will be under inventory control. Now, let us say, like in the current situation, when the transportation was on halt, the supply of necessary goods, whether the stock is there or not. So if because people will be needing it, how far we can provide them. So when we check on that, that will be the inventory control. Next is sales control. Sales control says that it ensures the sales achievement and profit objective of the organization. Now, profit objective of the organization, the organization always decides in the planning phase that, okay, in this particular financial year or in this particular quarter, this much sales have to be occurred so that the profit margin will be this. Now, sales control says that how much means the company was able to sell and how far the deviation occurred. So to match the profit objective of the organization with the sales of the organization, only when the coordination is very efficient and effective, then only this gap can be bridged. Next is credit control. Now, credit control says that it is a strategy in which the lenders ensure that they lend money only to customers with a great good credit record. Now, you can talk about the way banks provide loans, how they value a particular customer, because credit rating scores are there, and if your credit rating scores are good, then you will be getting loan in an easy manner. So this can be taken as an example of credit control. Or in case of organizations, if they have a particular supplier or particular vendor, so if they are taking on a credit, how far they are, means what is their track record shows that how they manage all these things. So that is credit control. Next is personnel control. Personnel control is the workers who work for the organization, how the control mechanism is applicable to them in terms of treatment to the workers, the employees, then the remuneration part of the workers, the motivational aspect of the workers, and the productivity aspect of the workers. All these aspects which are there associated with the personnel or the employees of the organization, these will be considered as the personnel control. The next is production control. Production control says
that the material supply, how these materials are processed, how the finished good is coming up, then how it is affecting the organizations, means how the system can overall utilize the available labor and capital in the optimum level, that will all come under, these all will come under production control. The next one is capital expenditure control. Now, under capital expenditure control, it is basically, it is used to identify, forecast, assess, and decide and manage capital expenditure. Identify, forecast, assess, decide, and manage capital expenditure. Whatever capital is available with the organization, on what basis they are spent, like plant, equipment, whether you are investing in a new property, then all these aspects will be considered under capital expenditure control. Next is safety control. Safety control talks about taking a stock of the kind of health hazards at the workplace, like avoiding injury, the illness which occurred because of the nature of the work, the incidents which occur in the organization at the workplace, then minimizing or eliminating the safety and health risks, all these will come under safety control. Now, why it is also important? Because let us say the organization is not taking proper control over here. So if the worker faces any health hazard because of the nature of the work, that will create the problem for a company, because the company has to pay the compensation. So safety control is also very important. Sir, please, the next slide. Yeah. Coming to unit 20 here, techniques of controlling are of the focal point. Now, so controlling can have different types of techniques, means how you are implementing the controlling mechanism, that can be done in various ways. Basically, they are divided into two. One is traditional techniques, one is the modern techniques. Now, coming to the traditional techniques of the controlling, under traditional techniques of controlling, there are various types which are mentioned. Sir, please, the next slide. Sir, the next slide, please. Under traditional technique, the first one is personal observation. Personal observation. So under personal observation, what happens that here it is considered to be the oldest controlling technique which is available. Here the supervisor will personally observe the workers while they perform the activity. So as and when the activity is performed, the supervisor's responsibility is to check whether they are going in the pre-planned way or not, or if discrepancy occurs, then how to rectify it. The next is setting examples. Now, under setting examples, it is like managers can set examples by showing how they do the work. For example, say punctuality. If the manager is punctual, then he can set example in front of his subordinates that how they need to behave in the workplace. The next is plans and policies. Now, these plans and policies are from the these are the organizational plans, policies, procedures, strategies, rules, regulations, which will govern the behavioral aspect and the production aspect of the workers. Next is organizational charts and manuals. Organizational charts and manuals, they will show how the jobs are related to each other, what are the responsibilities assigned to each of the jobs or the tasks, what are the duties of the employees, everything will be shown in that chart and manual. So if these documents are very clearly formulated and defined, then that can provide guidance for controlling the behavior. The next is disciplinary system. Disciplinary system says that it is basically talks about criticism, punishment, likewise. If deviation occurs, then by criticizing or by giving punishment or punitive, by taking punitive actions, the discrepancy can be bridged. So again, this is not something which is very, very much popular, because it is kind of a harsh thing. So this should be the last resort for the manager. The next is statistical data. Statistical data means here, basically the data related to the previous years that will be taken into consideration. Now, in here, what will happen? In here, what will happen is that the statistical data will show in forms of different tables, charts, figures, and graphs. This data will show how the work is done, if the deviation has occurred, when it has occurred. All these things will be shown in case in the context of production, quality, inventory, and sales. And by that, the control can happen. The next is written instructions. Now, written instructions can come in the format of notices, letters, circulars, bulletins. They will be giving the proper instructions for the workers as to how to perform and the way how to the things will be done. If any change in rules and regulations happen, then in a through a circular, everybody will be getting to know how, means the new course of action, how they need to give a performance or the productivity. The next is special reports and records. Now, special reports and records, these are related to different operations of the concern. Like many a times the experts only, they prepare these reports. Then if a certain kind of problem has occurred in a previous situation, how they are, that has been tackled, then what are the solutions for it. So accordingly also the control mechanism can be processed. The next one is operational audit. Now, operational audit says that in the operational phase, in the implementation phase, when the work is continuing, how it is done. So audit can be, audit means audit refers to the internal operation of the organization. So the internal audit, it gives a review of overall working of the organization. And from there, we know that what are the different loopholes or drawbacks and how to improve upon them. Next is financial statements. Now, financial statements, they comprise of the profit and loss account and the balance sheet. From that also, the employees can get a very clear-cut idea ki what was the objective, means what was the profit set for the organization, how far the organization was able to achieve it. So from financial statements also, we can implement the controlling. Next is break-even analysis. Now, break-even analysis is one technique which is widely used by different organizations. Here, the organization has to find out the break-even point. So, break-even point means where the total cost is equal to the total revenue. After means it can be considered as a point of no profit, no loss. After that, when you go upward, will be considered as making profits. So here, how to achieve the break-even point, and after that, how to achieve profit. This technique is used for that. The next is cost accounting and control, cost control. Now, cost accounting and cost control, it basically talks about the labor cost, the material cost, the overhead cost, everything it is considered for. Now, how if we are about to develop or our efficiency, our effectiveness, how to reduce the cost. These things will be a focal point in this particular technique. The next one is budget and budgetary control. I think I have forgotten to mention it. So now, budget and budgetary control. This one is budget are used as the controlling technique as in the most of the organizations. From the beginning of the financial year, a budget will be set. For every department, for every subsystem, the budget will be assigned. And according to the budget which is assigned to you, the department has to function within that limit. So that can also work as a very good measure of controlling. Now let us discuss the modern techniques of controlling. The first one is return on investment. So return on investment, it is a controlling technique to control the overall performance of the organization. wherever the organization has invested on. Depending on that, the organization can think of different ways how to get a return on that investment. This investment can be on humans, like the labor force or the workforce. This investment can be on different materials. This investment can be in different aspects. So how the organization is getting a return on that investment, through that the controlling mechanism can be applicable. The next is management audit. Management audit, basically it evaluates the performance of various management functions and processes. Let us say one particular position is not contributing to anything. Means that position is becoming irrelevant or it is becoming obsolete. Then that can be removed if this management audit is done. So, or the kind of tasks which will be included or introduced, the kinds of tasks which can be eliminated because these are of no use or not profitable or contributing towards the organization. So through management aid audit, these things can be analyzed and the corrective actions can be taken. Next is management information system. Management information system, basically why it is considered as a modern technique, because it is assisted with the help of technology. It provides the overall picture of the workflow in the organization, the different departments of the organization, scientifically it collects, organizes, processes and stores the information, it communicates the information and the database is maintained, as and when it is required, the relevant data can be extracted from it and it can be applied on the day-to-day work basis. So management information system comes under the modern technique of controlling. The next one is zero-based budgeting. Zero-based budgeting is a concept in which, under this concept, previous year's performance of the organization is not considered when the budget is prepared for a new financial year. So, under this technique, the determination of the budget does not take the previous period's performance into account. Rather, the budget is prepared in a fresh way, considering the information without considering the information which is available from the previous periods or previous years. Now, the next one is PERT CPM. PERT is Program Evaluation and Review Technique. CPM is Critical Path Method. Now, these two are a very important controlling technique as far as planning, scheduling, and controlling is concerned. Now, with the help of these techniques, the managers can complete the project on schedule because they provide you the path. The critical path method, for example, it provides the alternatives and which path is the best one to achieve the target or achieve the result in the optimum way possible. So when the manager can have this technique at their hand, they can achieve the work or complete the project on schedule. Now, the next one is coordination and communication. So here, now let us discuss the first one, which is which talks about coordination. So obviously, coordination, as the name suggests, it is about synchronization of efforts. If synchronization of efforts is not there in an organization, it can create a problem in achievement of the overall organization. Even if the planning is perfect and everything, the division of the work is there, everything is there, if proper coordination is not there, then the work can be derailed. Now, the two definitions which are provided here, from there you can see that coordination is orderly arrangement of group efforts to provide unity of action. As I have told you, that proper synchronization of work has to be there in order to achieve a common goal. The second definition also focuses on that integration of several parts into orderly whole. So that the achievement of the organization's objective will be there. Now, next comes to the needs and significance of the coordination. The first one is increase in size and complexity of the operations. Now, increase in size and complexity of operations, what does it mean? It means that as the organization grows in size, the complexity of the operation will also increase. For example, like I have given in the beginning of the session of ITC, from a basic functional structure, it becomes a diversified structure. It has a diversified structure. Now, as the different divisions are added to it, the complexity of the work also has increased. So if proper coordination is not there, the organization cannot perform well. So increase in size and complexity of operation demands for coordination. Next is specialization. Now, under specialization, now each division and subdivision have their own work responsibilities, the techniques of the work that will also differ from each of the functional areas. Now, but again, as they are part of the same organization, they all contribute towards the achievement of the overall objective. So if proper coordination is between or among the all the functional units or divisions or subdivisions, then only the organization can achieve the objective. Next is clash of interest. Now, clash of interest means to reduce the clash of interest. Coordination helps in reducing the clash of interest, because in an organization, the number of employees are there, many employees are there, and each of the employees, they are different from each other. They have certain physiological and psychological needs which they need to achieve through the job which they do. So how this means, only when a proper coordination and communication is there, this clash of interest can be reduced. Next is different outlook. Now, different outlook means whenever we consider ourselves, even at our home, if you have siblings, even though siblings, they are not just the same as you, even if you belong to the same family. Likewise, in an organization, no two employees are just the same. Each individual has his or her own way of thinking, of working. They have a different approach towards the problem. So coordination can help a proper implementation of this coordination function that can help in utilizing the different skills, approaches, then context, understanding of all these different employees. The next is interdependence of units. Now, when it comes to interdependence, basically three types of interdependences are there: pooled, sequential, and reciprocal. Now, pooled interdependence means, here the all the organization means all the subunits of the organization, let us say the parent organization, take example of any global company like Google or Microsoft, they have presence all over the world. Now, the unit which is there in India and the unit which is, let us say, they are in Australia, they are separate from each other, but they take their resources from the same headquarter. That is known as a pooled interdependence. The units are not dependent on each other, or in other words, we can say the units are completely independent of each other, but they source all their resources from the same point or the center. That is called as pooled interdependence. Next is sequential interdependence. Sequential interdependence means after only one finishes his or her work, the next will start. Let us say A, B, C, D, these four people are given the responsibility of completing a particular work. Only when A finishes the work, then only B can start the work. So here, A's end work will be B's input. So after B finishes, then C will start the work. So B's output will be C's input. So that is called as sequential interdependence. Next one is reciprocal interdependence. So reciprocal interdependence does not have a proper sequence. Under reciprocal interdependence, what happens is that, like the same example, we can consider A, B, C, D. Maybe after A finishes, B will start. After A finishes, D will start the work. After D, it will come to B. After B finishes, then it may go back to A. So it is kind of a network thing. So in sequential interdependence, the probability of misunderstanding and, sorry, in reciprocal interdependence, the probability of miscommunication or a conflict is much more in comparison to pooled and the sequential interdependence. Next is conflict. Under conflict, the coordination of activities, if it is properly done, then it can be avoided. It can help in avoiding the conflict. Now, if coordination is not properly done, it can be potential source of conflict. So coordination is very important in order to minimize the level of conflict in the organization. Now, let us go to the next one, which is principles of coordination. Now, principles of coordination, first one is of direct contact. Now, direct contact says that whenever there is a gap between the people who are involved in the work, a proper communication is not there, then conflict occurs, gap occurs. So if direct contact happens in the with the entire team which is involved in the completion of the task, then the instances of conflict will get reduced. Next is principle of coordination in early stages. Now, this says that in the early stages of the workflow, if effective coordination is there, then the members get a clear understanding who is supposed to be doing what and up to what extent the level of interdependency is there, like they are dependent on each other, and how the flow of work will happen. So if these are communicated to them in an early stage, then the reduction of conflict can happen. The next is principles of continuous process of coordination. Principle of continuous process of coordination, it says that whenever one coordination is not, it doesn't happen for a single time that it has done, so it is finished. No. So here it is an ongoing process. Every time as the work flows along with it, the coordination will also flow. And in every stage of the work, coordination will be there, like among different functional units, the different levels of the work, then the members of the team, for all of them, coordination has to be present all over the time. So it is a continuous process. Last is, it is situational authority. Again, coordination is considered to be a flexible one. Depending on the law of the situation, the coordination can also be adaptable to that demand, the changing demand, to the changing demand of the situation. If, let us say, requirement of an authoritative figure or a controlling figure is not required for a specific teamwork because the team members are well capable enough to do that on their own, then this authoritative figure might not be required. So in that condition, the coordination will be different. If a team requires an authoritative figure who will be guiding in each and every step, in that particular case, the coordination will be different. So coordination also is under the situational authority. The next one is techniques of coordination. First one is sound planning. Sound planning says that sound planning means a healthy planning. How means planning, how the coordination will flow. Then how the communication will be established, who will be doing what, how the workflow will be continued, what they are expected to do, how to do, when to do. When these are properly defined, then coordination can happen properly. Next is simplified organization. Simplified organization means the organization structured should be kept as simple as possible. The more complexity the organizational structure will involve, more complexity will be there in communicating, because might be there that will create a confusion whose order to take. If you have dual reporting authority because of a complex structure, whose authority will be the final one, whose order to be considered as the primary one, whose order to be considered as the secondary one. If this kind of confusions occur, then it can hamper the productivity of the employees. For that reason, an organization must have a simplified structure as far as possible. Next is effective communication. So effective communication is about the open and regular communication. Again, this must take both the formal communication and informal communication channel into consideration. The next is effective leadership and supervision. Now, effective leadership and supervision, it says that only when effective leadership and supervision is there, then only coordination can happen in a proper way. Because with the effective leadership, presence of effective leadership in the organization, the communication can happen in a very proper way. So planning, execution, everything can be done smoothly. Next is chain of command. Chain of command, as it is also discussed in the principles of management, the unity of command principle. So chain of command says who will be coming after whom, so and who will be reporting to whom. So when all these things are properly defined and it is clearly understood by the employees, then there will be a smooth coordination among the different levels and the different parts of the organization. Next comes incentives. Now incentives, it helps in securing coordination. Incentives can help in securing coordination. Now, if you know that with proper coordination, if you can achieve the productivity and you can be efficient and effective, with that what happens? That the organization will also be profitable. Now, the employees can have the share in the profit. So that is the incentive of developing a good coordination among the different levels and parts. Next is liaison of departments. Now, departments, even if functionally they are different from each other, but the liaisoning has to be there. So there are officers who are responsible for liaisoning with other departments outside and inside of the organization. They are considered as the linking pin. Why it is linking pin? Because they are primarily responsible for linking the different departments with each other, maybe inside the organization or outside the organization. The last one is voluntary coordination. So voluntary coordination means it is not that always somebody will force you to coordinate among each other. Rather, it should come from the side of the employees, which is called as the self-coordination. How to improve coordination among each other? It should not always flow from the authority, rather it should come from the employee himself or herself. Next is types of coordination. First one is coordination within the individual. Now, within the individual means the individuals, when they work, like how the flow of work will be there, what to, when to start, how to start, what should be the speed of the work. So the individual has to coordinate with himself or herself how to complete the work in a proper way. Next is the among individuals of a group consists of two or more individuals. So among the individuals also in the group, there has to be coordination or else the group objective will not be achieved. Next is among the groups of an enterprise. Inside the enterprise, there are different groups of workers, employees who will be working. It can be in the form of department. It can be form of a sub part of a department. So different groups will be working. Coordination also have to be under within them so that the work will be happening. The entire work will be happening in a proper way. Next is coordination among enterprises and forces of the world. We can consider a lot of examples like forces of the world. Let us say when we talk about the trade relationships between two countries or two or more countries, we can take example of different bodies like SAARC is there or NAFTA is there or like OPEC is there. So different kinds of bodies are there who work among each other for the optimum utilization of resources available to them. So coordination can be in these different types. So the last part, which I have not mentioned in the slides, like the benefit of the coordination. Benefit of the coordination, like higher efficiency will be there. Obviously, good relationship will be there. Then unity of direction, it will be there. Then organizational effectiveness. In the other points, we already have discussed all about it. Then coordination will only happen with a proper communication channel. This communication can be, this is a very commonly studied topic of communication, a sender, message, encoding, media, decoding, receiver, and feedback. So a sender sends a message, which is transferred to the receiver through a media or a channel. Then it is decoded by the receiver, and then the receiver provides feedback to the sender. Now there can be different like barriers from the sender side. It can also be barrier. There can also be barriers from the receiver side. There can be different barriers, like noise can be there, the physical noise can be there, or psychological barrier can be there. Like if I do not want to listen, then I won't be getting the proper coming, means the meaning. So psychological barrier can be there, organizational barrier can be there, or personal barrier can be there, the attitude, the understanding of a person, the poor hearing, the distance. So physical barriers can be there. So all these will be there, which needs to be avoided as far as possible for a proper and clear communication. So this is the end of the session of coordination and communication. So thank you all for making it smooth. Thank you, Ansuman sir, for helping me out.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I must offer my apology that due to some technical reasons, the PowerPoint slide was not visible.
No,
not
sir. No, it was
moving
not a
on
problem
time.
At all. It was not a problem, sir.
I believe it created some kind of confusion for the learners, as well as it might have resulted in some kind of difficulty for you. Anyways, I offer my apology. I could not do it.
You have
it was
helped
a technical
me, sir, in
point.
The maximum way, optimum way possible, sir. It was not a problem at all.
Thank you so much, ma'am. You have been kind enough to accept our invitation and be our resource person for the day, and you have covered a lot of very crucial and important aspects related to planning, related to coordination, related to the basic managerial functions like controlling. So we have been benefited, we have been empowered as participants. So thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Looking
for
forward to
me.
Your thank you. Looking forward to other sessions. Thank you so
thank
much,
you,
ma'am.
Sir. Thank you.
So we end this session here. Thank you so
okay.
much.
Okay. Thank you.